microphone because I think there's something with this one. Anyway, so the resilience is something which is kind of not really defined in a way, and many people are kind of thinking what this resilience is. And at least part of my lecture will be a little bit better definition of resilience. You can say that resilience intrinsically is clear. If somebody is very strong and whatever you do to him, he survives and he gets even better, you say this guy is resilient. So in history, we have these resilience structures and we learned how to build them long time ago. I had a very nice weekend before coming to Acapulco with my colleague here, Alberto Dominguez, who showed me that this region here, and I apologize, I was ignorant about historical aspects of this region, especially Aztec culture and the role they played, was a little bit like Roman Empire of the neighborhood, with really lots of developed type of structures that are still standing today. So instead of a Colosseum in Rome, I could have used the Chichen Itza, I could have used the I keep forgetting the name, or Theo or something like that, next to the Mexico City, and they are still standing. However, these structures are built by very rich people. At that time, there was only one king, and they could afford to build a very strong structure. Unfortunately, today you have to build kind of a little bit, let's say, less costly structure because there are not that many kings anymore. So, to understand resilience, I'd say I was also resilient because I guess I did the inverse to many paths that people did. After my studies at Berkeley, I went back to Europe simply because I had a Fulbright scholarship. For those who don't know, that was also part of my home country, which is Yugoslavia. I was born in Sarajevo. I'm French today for now years. By that time, that allowed me, that obliged me to leave the United States. And I found the quality of life in Europe is as good as in the US. And it didn't really go so bad for me, I would say. In any sense, what we have in France, it's really original way of structuring the research. And I again try to argue this is very compatible to the resilience and ocean resilience. Namely, you don't have only a narrow type of laboratory like earthquake engineering or structures or material or soils, but you put the whole civil engineering, and on top of that you put the whole mechanical engineering, and on top of that you put the whole material science. And this was my laboratory for about 15 years. It's called the École Normale Supérieure de Cachan. This is the school that a couple of your colleagues here completed there, a very prestigious school in Paris because it's only 2 kilometers outside. And so basically the school, nothing wrong with that. I was very happy there, and especially they had a really the complete, I would say, application of mechanics. The laboratory I was working with as a vice director was a laboratory of mechanics and technology. It means you take mechanics and you take any application possible from the airplanes, trains, bridges, buildings, to whatever is mechanics could be interested in solving. The only thing which pushed me into thinking about leaving after 15 years, they had politicians really in France. They were bothered that Chinese did not notice that French universities are great, so they want to put all the historical schools together. So they called Polytechnique, they called Centrale, they called Mines, they called Normale Supérieure. We'll go to the remote location 40 kilometers away. I decided then it's not a good idea because it will be called Paris-Saclay, and by the time the world learns that Saclay is a big deal, many years will go by. So then I decided to stay with people who are staying in Paris. And in fact, there's a so-called the University of the Pierre Marie Curie, which is the best known by the French, by the Chinese ranking. And they are together with the Paris Sorbonne, which is the best known for those of you who are not only engineers, but you also have a philosophical side of you, and literature, and so on and so forth. So these two got together, and they asked Technical University of Compiègne to join them, also business school inside, and so on and so forth. So this university was not as good as these two first, so they, I guess they started creating these chair positions to kind of strengthen their role. And that was the reason I came there, with the role of doing innovation. Innovation is a little bit difficult to understand, but I interpret innovation as a possibility to develop the research where industry can actually use it. The sooner the better. And it's actually also an advantage to work with people from Pierre Marie Curie, from Paris Sorbonne, because really you have a complementary skills. Not a contrary to Saclay, where all of the engineering schools are getting together. Here it's like philosophers and let's say physics, chemistry, and so on, and plus engineers. And also was lucky enough to get something EUF. This is not the French Academy of Science, but these active professors, the Academy of Science rely upon, and they can actually do only research. So it's really like teaching only doctoral courses and doing lots of research. That is why I can stay for 10 days in Acapulco in the middle of the academic year, just to explain. Now, another big deal about French system, lately we have created so-called LabEx or laboratory excellence. That means you take the best laboratories of even different universities and you put them together in order to be top world level in the in certain domain. So Technical University of Compiègne is one of the few who had a LabEx, which involves only laboratories let's say, the same university. This is roughly 150 people, this is our mechanics, 170-180, and this is like 50, so roughly 400 researchers. When I say researchers, this is professor, lecturers, and doctoral students. So it's really a very big type of group. They compare this to orchestra. I would say it's orchestra, sometimes it's not really playing so clearly. In any sense, we are still trying to make sense what exactly is this system, the system technologic, and what is the metrics. This would be mastering system of system technological. Actually, the name of system comes from the military type of jargon, and if you think of that, for example, control colleagues, they work on these small drones. So if you fly a single drone, that's a simple system. If you fly the whole escadrille, that means like 10, 20, 100 drones at the same time, then you call it system of system. What we are learning to do is actually you go much more deeply into the interpretation, because the control people are flying these drones without thinking about what they are doing, if they are flexible or if they have a durability or so on and so forth, and we are really trying to put this together. And I think this is precisely what resilience is all about. This is really overpouring over traditional domain, and you can try to work with the people who are experts in another domain. And somebody should be somehow connecting the whole thing. So this is still not clear whether it should be one person or it should be some kind of clever interaction among different people. If you think of that internet was invented because US Army wanted to keep being resilient after eventual nuclear war, and they can keep the command after the, let's say, the headquarters or the high command was destroyed. This is something I would say that goes along those lines. What's the best way of dealing with this? In any case, we have at least theoretically well-prepared structure, and for the moment, I would say just listing some of these possibilities, one of them, for example, dealing with the natural disasters, and think of this kind. In any case, if you think of that, what resilience means to you as a structural or earthquake engineer, I would say that first of all, you have to get much better in what you're doing, because you are going to be talking to other specialists. So being better in what you're doing, that means you can more easily explain to another specialist what exactly you're talking about. If you know only little, you keep repeating this little. If you know a little bit more, then you can say this in three different ways, hoping that somebody who is talking to you can understand this much better than if you keep saying the same story over and over again. And it's also, another point is that you really have to keep open spirit and be able to do the teamwork. Not the teamwork where you don't do anything and you look for somebody who's the more efficient, but actually teamwork where you can really learn from some other people who are expert in different domains. So let me first address you as a structural engineer. What does that mean? Up to now, structural engineering and earthquake engineering was really very simplified models, and you're kind of fitting it to suit particular need. Right now, you really have to go into dig much deeper, because the information that is going to be asked for you is much more refined than what used to be up to now. In other words, what I take the first type of theme of this lecture is compare what is material versus structural point of view. In civil engineering, you have people doing materials and you have people doing structures. If you want to do resilience, I think you have to do both. And not only that, but you have to understand sufficiently about probability aspects. Because when you go to this material scales, the world is not deterministic, and it really counts a lot. So let me show you what these are. Usual reminder, and unfortunately I don't have to remind people coming from Mexico, and Mexico City in particular, about earthquake. There's no photograph, we don't need them, unfortunately. Again, this is certainly by far the biggest source of human casualties and damages in the world. And basically in France, in general, good part of Europe, in Northern Europe where I come from, we fortunately do not have the threat of earthquake. Can you play this video here? Just click it on that one. On the other hand, we still care about earthquake simply because the source of electricity in France by 90% is something like a nuclear power. So this is this cooling tower, wonderful structure, but they don't care about it. What they care about is this little ugly guy, which is sheltering the nuclear reactor in the case of the explosion. You can see the worst case scenario when it exploded. This is a reduced size test that was made in Sandia National Laboratory, and we can reproduce type of things perfectly. But what is really needed, and what's completely new information in this type of scenario, is not only wait until this moment, because then it's way too late. Actually, you could see at a certain point, I didn't really grab this moment immediately, but you can see that a tiny leak, and that's given that inside is a radioactive type of substance, the people living next to this nuclear power plant already could be in danger, because living next to nuclear power plant for years, of course, this is very hazardous for your health. So everybody in France lives somewhere near the nuclear power plant, given the number of nuclear power plants that are there. So there's actually, first of all, durability issue. Can you keep them for such a long time? And on top of that, there's an extreme event like earthquake. So then you have to worry about combining something that goes for a very long time. That means durability. Instead of 30 years, you have to go to 60 years. Imagine integrating something for 60 years. And on top of that, there is earthquake which lasts, let's say, a couple of minutes. And you have to combine these two types of loadings. In fact, nuclear power plant is already a system, it's not really a structure. And if you look closely into what happened in Fukushima, the nuclear reactor did not fail, actually. What failed is that after earthquake and tsunami, there was this cooling water pipe type of system that kind of, the engines burned down, so the circulation of water stopped, and the reactor was no longer cooled. And being overheated over a certain period of time, it just exploded. So this type of analysis already attracted the work when I was at Berkeley, working with the people like Ed Wilson and Bob Taylor. Ed Wilson is the author of probably the best known computer code in the domain of structural engineering. It's a SAP, a SAP, a structure analysis program, which is marketed by the Computers and Structures Incorporated in Berkeley. This was one of the things that we are doing. And right now, this is actually it's part of my thesis. And it's actually the so-called fast nonlinear analysis type of feature in SAP. In fact, what you can do is, in order to reduce vibration of this piping system, you put some of these energy absorption type of devices, you model them in the way that is kind of acceptable in earthquakes. At that time, it was done in 1992, typically Ramberg, Osgood type of models and things of this kind. And then basically you can show that there are efficient computational schemes which are fully implicit, gives you a reliable answer, but you reduce the model to such extent that it's just a fraction of the cost of the full nonlinear analysis and you get the answer that you're looking for. So on the other hand, we realize that getting interpretation of the damping by taking simplified model like Ramberg, Osgood and things of this kind is not good enough. So we decided today we really need a much better type of thing with energy absorption. So if you look at what everything that can happen in a typical earthquake engineering application, you have a nonlinear behavioral structure. Many of this is focused in the connections, be it civil or be it concrete or steel type of structure, and then you also have interaction with the soil that has to be taken into account, especially the site as a Mexico City. That, by the way, was also solved at that time and it was available in computer code itself. Today, resilience actually brings the need to have much better interpretation of this damping. Namely, if you just stay with the Rayleigh damping, this is really non-physical damping. You have these two damping coefficients. Some people say you take 2% for steel and you take 5% for concrete and that's about it. You cannot say that such a state is satisfying given that the typical response to earthquake has at least three distinct phases. Namely, there's a small vibration before severe damage, but then vibration will stop. This is typically due to some kind of, if you take a bridge and you have this type of neoprene type of supports, you can model this with some kind of viscosity of such a support. Or then you have a really strong shaking where you have lots of damage, then it's a plasticity and damage and things of this kind that goes into the game. And the third distinct phase of earthquake response would be free vibration or damage structure, in which case you have a frictional contact along these cracks that has to be taken into account. If you want to model such a model with such a damping with a model of Rayleigh kind, there's just no way you can fit these three different phases in a single shot. So we have to have better understanding what takes place, and this is, if you can run this figure, This is one of the experiments that are, for the moment, capable of performing in European research lab of earthquake engineering. You see these little ants. These are people walking, and they're walking normal pace, but the field was accelerated, so it looks like earthquake. Otherwise, this is so-called the pseudodynamic test, where actually the structure is standing still, but you are computing the response. Partially, you're computing, and then basically this computation is then applied at the level of every floor by using hydraulic jacks. You can do more realistic simulation of earthquake. You put the whole structure on the shaking table. Unfortunately, you cannot put the full-size structure because it's just too heavy. And so basically, I think that the largest shaking table is something like Japan, 150 tons, unless now UC San Diego has a big one. But in any case, you cannot put this high-rise building on top of that. So what we are doing in France, we were trying to kind of work out this, the reduced scale model. This was a national project trying to provide this reinforced concrete walls where you can reduce reinforcement because you have a better interpretation of the damage. And so contrary to the usual model, you can simply take a cantilever beam and you take a base shear as the final response. Here what you want to do is you want to look into the final local type of response and get the local damage of your structure. And then be able to predict this. Why am I bothering to do this? Because whatever is the size of this wall, if I know how to predict local response, I can then change the size of the wall. On the other hand, if I'm doing this in a base shear, stress resultant type of approach, there's no way you can extrapolate finding on one structure to finding another structure, the so-called size effect. And we are trying to get rid of the size effect given the fact that we are working with reduced size structures. This is a very complicated problem. Because if you take one-third smaller structure, you cannot take one-third weaker concrete or weaker steel or less concrete, less steel. The ratio is really nonlinear, and it's not really that obvious to see what exactly are you testing if you are testing the experiments of this kind. So you need much better understanding what is going on if you want to be predictive, if you want to be reliable with respect to the structural testing. I know it was lunchtime, but it's the first day of the conference, and I had to start putting some equations because it just doesn't happen by itself. You don't press the button, everything happens. There are certainly the modeling, there are then development, discretization, then there is a solution algorithm, there's a computer code development. All that is done not in a single code, but you will see in many different codes. And many of those things are available only to the really high level type of specialized companies for the moment. Unfortunately, they're not still diffused to the earthquake engineering profession. But I think this just takes some, let's say, resources and time, and this could be done in obvious way. So this is your usual nonlinear equation for earthquake. This is acceleration times mass and that, let's say, really dumping time velocity plus difference time displacement equal to, let's say, some kind of a loading which is coming from earthquake, ground motion. And basically, if you have a nonlinear response, this is not going to be simply difference time displacement. It could be internal force, which is nonlinear function displacement. And then we are trying to replace this Rayleigh dumping, so to say, to be able to reproduce this type of response in three different phases. In order to do that, we will try to see the really fiber scale model, go to the material scale, and hopefully to get parameters which are measured in terms of energy. That is, the material can generate certain energy while it's being damaged. So this energy is a physical parameter, I would say, that you actually establish at the material level test. I'll explain in a moment what I mean by that. Let me first show you the basic model that is not really that well known outside of France. This is so-called damage model. When you have a damage that goes from, there's so-called damage variable D that goes from 0 to 1. When there's no damage, D is equal to 0. When you have a full crack, it's equal to 1. And then you take Young's modulus, you multiply this by Y minus D. Obviously, when D goes to 1, Young's modulus is equal to 0. They would just want to say that whatever is the kind of, let's say, deformation, that there's no more resistance and stress. And that sense a little bit awkward, the fact that it goes to one, but